Gotcha. Good boy. So.
Oh, and remember, you want some slack. Okay. You're so used to holding on tight.
Yeah.
It's like the squealing happiness at the dog park. When Ed is doing something wrong, I want it to be more like the Rottweiler that thinks someone's breaking in. So I want you to go from almost from like party to funeral and back and forth, because we're communicating with an animal that speaks more tone than English. So we're going to try and get through to him what we like and what we don't like using our tone of voice as well as the corrections. So the things that I showed you in-house that we would use for corrections, we're also going to use our growly noise at the same time, always building it up so that one day, the Olympic medal day, will be when the doorbell rings and you can go, and he lets it go. Okay. The new job is to cooperate with us, to take direction from us, and to trust us that no matter what, we're not going to let anything bad happen to him.
Right.
Out here, you would change directions, you would randomly walk fast, you would walk slow. Go ahead and ask him this way. Buddy, sit. Ah! That's what I thought.
Ready to go back?
So this is this little game of follow the leader. Puts you in charge. It also mentally wears him out. So it takes a lot of energy to figure out how to get the treat, how to not get in trouble, how to not get the collar correction. All of this stuff is happening and he's getting exhausted. So the next time you run into a dog or a person that would normally alarm him, he doesn't have the same kind of mental energy built up that he would have before, because he's so used to following your lead and it's taken so much of his energy. So the first 10 minutes of your walk should always be like this.
Okay.
Wearing him out, playing follow the leader, asking him to go your way and do your things.
I think this collar, we just didn't really have a good collar because the one we had would just slip off his head anytime.
Yeah.
Try to do it.
Oh yeah, because their necks are as big as their heads. It's really strange.
He's incredibly strong. Yeah. I would sit out here, I have a gym in the garage, and I have a 53-pound kettlebell, and I would put his leash on that thing. And I just, because he wanted to hang out with me while I was working out.
Yes.
And when somebody would walk by, he would drag that 52-pound kettlebell down the driveway.
Yeah.
There's a big scratch in the concrete from him doing that.
Good boy.
He's a beast.
Part of your follow the leader exercise is going to be having him start to lay down out here. So laying down is the most submissive thing that you could ask a dog to do. He's down and he's not ready to pounce. So anything could happen, this guy could fall, and we would jump on top of him and make sure everything is okay. So out here, we're playing follow the leader and we're doing walking fast, we're walking slow, we're changing directions a lot, we're making turns into him, we're making turns away from him, we're randomly asking him to sit and lay down. We're just totally dominating his walk and his life right now so that we can mentally wear him out, so that this little guy just won't have the mental energy that he does usually have to go off on a dog. And we'll have him do this as a good down, Okay. Okay, you can do whatever you want. Good boy. Good boy, Ed. Good boy. So let's go on inside again.
I just want to make sure I have a good collar for you.
There's still a tightening effect. So no matter what, he's not going to get it off.
Yeah.
But I want it to be nice and loose so that he doesn't feel that he's wearing a training collar or he's not getting pinched all the time.
Right.
I just want him to feel that when you're sending him a message, when you're communicating with him. And that's what we're doing. The training collar allows us to communicate with him in the moment out on a walk. Everybody knows that if you're potty training a puppy, for instance, it's best to catch him in the act. Why would it be any different out on a walk?
Yeah.
So you want to catch them in the act and you want to get their attention and you want to let them know right away in the act of what they're doing that you disapprove of what they're doing. And that's where the growling noise comes in too. When dogs disapprove of what dogs are doing, they growl at each other. They put up a growly voice and their voice is deep. Even their bark is deep. Mm-hmm. But when they approve of what's going on, it's a real high pitch, like squealy, happy bark. Mm-hmm. Hi, Ed, are you going to be a good boy? So, between the follow the leader exercise out on the walk and the who is responding to whom exercise in the house, you guys are going to be busy this week just trying to figure out, like, coordinating how much of a correction does it take to get his attention. Mm-hmm. There's 20 levels in this collar, and they're all in your wrist. So maybe just a little bit when there's nothing going on. Maybe you have to really give them a correction when there's dogs around or something and you have to speak a little bit louder. But that's going to take some coordination on your part to try and get your part right. Mm-hmm. And for him to start to understand that things are changing. Mm-hmm. Things have to change. He can't be this way anymore.
Right.
Good boy. Oh, wait, are you going to tell me to scratch your tummy? Are you? I'll do it. Because I'm here to make friends with you, man. I'm here to make friends. Yeah. Good boy. Yeah, you gonna tell me to? Okay. So it's a command. You like that? Okay. Now, I come in here and I'm a little bit like you. I act like a bit of a sucker. And I pet them and I sit on the floor and I'm not Caesar Milan. I'm not staring at them and I'm not making weird noises, you know, and I'm petting them and I'm loving them just the way you're going to when I leave. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing. I'm showing him love and affection along with leadership.
Yeah.
So a good pack leader is going to be fair and kind and loving, but they're going to have control of what's going over. They're going to have the decision-making factor is going to be on their side all the time. This guy's not free to make decisions anymore because he doesn't know what a car is, and we do, right? It's best that we be in charge. They're not as smart as we are, and they need a leader. When you rescue a dog, especially, they come into our lives, and for the first month, you will notice their best behavior. Mm-hmm. A lot of times, things won't start in the first month. You won't see the bad behaviors for about a month. But it will start growing after that. But the thing is, it already existed. It's just that they're on their best behavior because they don't know you yet. They're not comfortable yet. Once they get comfortable, the behavior that got them in trouble to begin with starts to come out, and then you get to see it. But they come into our lives, and we human beings are kind. We're nurturing. We don't just believe in equality. We strive for equality. So we're completely foreign in the way we think and our mentalities. They're pack animals. If there's no clear leadership here, then it's got to be him. And then if he's in charge, he's just doing his job out there, and he doesn't understand why you're so unappreciative of it. He's doing a really good job protecting you. He's rocking it, and you guys don't appreciate it at all, right? What's wrong with them? What's wrong with them that they don't know that I'm doing my job? Doing a good job.
And I like the idea of him being, you know, more mentally exhausted. So if we're walking him in the morning, I mean, how often do you think we should
walk? Oh, you can walk him twice a day. You can do normal walks. Just make the first 10 minutes a nice follow the leader game.
Yeah, yeah.
And bring out some treats and make it fun for him so that we're really tricking him into learning.
And we have three boys, and they love Ed, so their job is going to be to make him sit or lay down before they give him any affection.
Any affection
at all. And they love, you know, practicing the
shake
and all of that too, yeah.
Yeah, he's got a new trick too. He's really smart, so he's going to get bored if you guys are not training him. He just learns shake in like 2 minutes flat. So he's a smart dog, and if you're not challenging him, he will get bored and he will start acting out. Mm-hmm. Now, I want to take a look at the food that you're feeding this dog.
Okay.
Do you have the bag by chance?
No, I can pull it up on Amazon. Yeah.
I'm looking
it's
for
the same food that the previous owner had been doing, so we just stuck with that.
That makes sense. I'm looking for how many carbs are you putting into this dog's system, because carbs turn sugar, mm-hmm. just like with us,
right?
And they create hyperactivity, not just physical, but mental hyperactivity, which is so much worse.
Yeah.
They're like looking for threats.
Right.
They can't listen to you, they can't hear you, they're very busy. Mm-hmm. So if you look at the first 10 ingredients of any dog food, you should see a little bit of potato or a little bit of rice or something, but you're not gonna see like 4 or 5 carbs in the first 10 ingredients. And if you do, that's a part of your problem.
Okay.
Bison, number one ingredient. But then it just has like a list of like lentils, carrots, canola oil, peas, sweet potatoes.
It doesn't
list it.
What's the brand? Maybe you would be familiar with it.
Canada.
What's the crude protein percentage? Does it say that?
No.
Okay, well, next time you get the bag.
The number one ingredient is bison. That's what that is.
Well, that's not bad then.
Yeah.
But I want to know number 2 through 8.
Doesn't show the percentage.
I want to know where they lie in how much is in, you know, what's number 2 and what's number 3, because there's a lot in there.
Right.
So if you have a food that's, say, salmon and rice already, it's half carbs. Mm-hmm. And then if you add barley and oatmeal and a couple other things, then you're up there. Your dog is sugared out. Mm-hmm. So next time you get the bag, I want you to look at the bag and actually look at the first 10 ingredients and the structure of them.
Okay.
And find out like where your carbs are and in how much is in there.
Are the labels like a typical food label?
Yeah.
Like the percentage?
Yeah, they'll have,
like
it'll rank.
Protein, fat,
and then it'll have a percentage. Carbs. I like to go 30% or higher on protein.
Yeah.
So if you go high protein, low carb diet, you'll have a calmer dog. You'll have a dog that can listen to you. They're more grounded. Mm-hmm. They're less anxiety, less stress, less nervousness, less aggression. It happens all the time.
Okay.
Get a squirt bottle with mostly water and just a little bit white distilled vinegar. Okay. It's the gift that keeps on giving. So you aim for the nose, but it kind of sinks in, and the smell and the taste linger for a few minutes. And whatever they were doing at that moment, when they got that squirt in the face, they're not going to want to do, they're going to think twice about continuing to do it over and over again.
Okay.
What we need to do is find a way to make it unpleasant for him to do the unwanted behavior.
Right.
If he's having fun and it's pleasant for him, then why would he ever stop doing it?
Mm-hmm.
Now, aggression is a rush. So when he's going off and he's barking and he's lunging and he's acting crazy, he's getting endorphins and chemicals are being released into his body and into his brain, and it feels good. So it's a lot different than trying to teach him to sit with a treat.
Mm-hmm.
You're taking away something that is like his favorite hobby.
Mm-hmm.
So I want you to have food.
Mm-hmm.
If he can walk by another dog like a gentleman, it's worth a treat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want you to have treats with you initially,
okay,
so that the reward for acting the way we want him to is high, and then the consequence for reacting in the way that we don't want him to is also high.
Mm-hmm. So would we bring the treats on a walk, but not the spray bottle?
Mm-hmm.
No, that's just
you
like
have
home.
The collar.
Yeah,
on the walk.
The spray bottle's just like at home when he's barking.
At home when he's barking, lunging, or headed for the door.
Okay.
In fact, I would want you to meet him at the door and back him off with the squirt bottle.
Mm-hmm.
Back him off so that he realizes that that door does not belong to him,
nice,
and that what's on the other side of it doesn't concern him at all.
Okay.
And see if you can't get him to let go of what's going on in the door, right? I don't know if these things would work for you or not. Like what I'll do is I'll actually walk out the door. I'll give you this.
Okay.
And I'll walk out the door and I'll ring the bell again. Give me a minute. You can stay in here.
spray.
Good. Good boy, Ed.
Good boy.
Anna, what a good boy.
Good boy.
Such a good boy.
He's backing away from me now.
That's okay. That's okay. That's good.
Good boy.
He found something that he respects.
Yeah.
He didn't respect it when I did it, but he doesn't trust me. Yeah. He doesn't love me. He loves you and he trusts you. So coming from you is a different story.
Okay.
Shake. Good job. Shake.
Yeah.
Here's some treats.
Good boy.
You got them?
Good boy. Down.
Here's some treats. Yeah. So this spray bottle right here specifically says for barking, jumping up, lunging, stealing food, you name it, getting up on the furniture. And that way you have a way to back him off from the door. That's no longer his job, no longer his concern, and a need for you to come with strong intentions that you don't want him over there anymore.
Yeah.
That it, who cares? Nobody is over there asking if he can come out and play. There's nobody asking for him.
Right.
Okay.
Now, what about tug of war play? Does that teach
not really. I mean,
manners?
Rough play, where you're really promoting bitey games.
Well, he likes to kind of, he'll like, you know, when I come home and, you know, he wants to like kind of come at me with his mouth a little bit, and it's gotten better because I don't encourage it anymore, but he'll, you know, he's very like the oral fixation thing.
I would correct it with the collar. Because it's directly
connected. I usually
connected.
Just ignore him now, and he's actually mellowed
out. Yeah, turn our back to him.
It is directly connected. A lot of Frenchies have an oral fixation, and they will go and get something in their mouth. Like, you come home, and they're excited, and they'll run and get something in their mouth, and they're literally holding something in their mouth in order to feel comfortable. So
yeah, he has his red ball that he like will just grab and sit on his bed. And
don't
just
pet him when he's doing that. If he goes to grab the ball, and he comes back to you with the ball in his mouth, have him drop the ball before you pet him.
Okay.
So don't feed the oral fixation.
Right.
He's okay without something in his mouth.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if he's just chilling in the house and nobody's like paying attention to him, if he goes for it. And he will, he growls like when you try to take it from him too.
Really?
Not so much with me anymore because I've given him the business a little bit, but with the boys and stuff, like he will.
He's better though, like he'll lay, and if he's laying down looking at his ball, the boys can lay like on him and pet him and he won't growl or anything.
He was a lot more protective of it.
I would put my foot down about that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I would not let that. That's not okay.
Okay.
You can't growl at me. If I'm going to tell you you can't growl and bite strangers, I'm going to better be telling him that you can't growl and bite us.
Yeah.
So you always have these two options. If you're in the mood to do what he wants you to do, when he comes to you with these adorable commands, if you're in the mood, if you feel like doing it and you have time, ask him to do something to earn it, to work for it.
Okay.
On the other hand, if you're on a business phone call, right, or you don't have time to give his every wish and command, you know, enough attention, then what I want you to do is send him packing. Tell him to kick rocks. And you didn't buy a ticket for the whole show that he's going to put on to try and get you to do what he wants you to do.
Yeah.
Just tell him no. People should be able to just say no to their dogs these days.
Yeah.
I don't know what has happened.
So another way that I think he's showing a command to us is he likes to be in my oldest son's room the most because we got him, he was doing school at home. So they're very bonded.
Later.
That's his first pick. And so he'll sit in front of the door and wait for one of us to open the door. So we should be having him lay down.
Have him lay down, have him sit, have him do something.
Okay.
If he's already sitting, have him lay down.
Good
if he's already sitting, have him shake.
Yeah.
If he's laying down, have him sit.
Lay down.